I am Chris Seberino, and we are continuing the basic machine learning series. And today I'm going to be talking about two important libraries, Scikit-learn and XGBoost. And as always, these slides and the notebooks I will be using are on our GitHub repository, which is accessible from the meetup page. And afterwards, we go to IHOP for dinner if anybody wants to join us. And also, again, there's a feedback form on the event section there if you want to give us feedback on how to improve. And if you want to continue the conversation, there's my email on this first slide. You can send me an email. And also, this presentation will be recorded so that you. So again, two libraries I'll be talking about, Scikit-learn and XGBoost. So I'm going to do Scikit-learn first. That one supports XGBoost. Well, it supports lots of things, but it's kind of like the Swiss Army knife of machine. So I want to put that up first. So Scikit-learn is an open source machine learning library. It helps with data preparation as well as building and evaluating models. So pretty much that sentence covers everything practically that you need to do in machine learning, right? You have to prepare your data, build your model, use the model, evaluate the model. So all of those steps, Scikit-learn has something to help you with that. And it supports the popular machine learning tools, Python, NumPy, Pandas. It supports several other packages and platforms, but those are three big ones in machine learning. So what are some of these tasks that Scikit-learn can help you with? So tasks such as shuffling. So you want to shuffle your data, make sure that the order of the data is not going to affect your results. One-hot encoding, a data set splitting. So if you're training a supervised model and you need to split into a training portion and a testing portion, Scikit-learn can help with that. Hyperparameter searches. I'll show you an example. I'll show you an example of a lot of these hyperparameter searches, looking for the right settings to make the most accurate model, cross validation. Okay, so and this is not an exhaustive list either. Okay, so now regarding other support, it includes support for classification and regression algorithms, and it includes all of the popular ones such as least squares, k-nearest neighbors, decision trees, random forests, gradient tree boosting, stochastic gradient descent, logistic regression, support vector machines, naive bayes, perceptrons, and neural networks. So probably anything you want to do, any type of model, Scikit-learn has support for. Also, once you build your model and you want to evaluate it, it includes support for accuracy metrics such as precision recall, F1 scores, mean absolute errors, root mean squared errors, and R squared values. You can also use it to to build and display confusion matrices. All right, so that is the overview of what you can do with Scikit-learn. So now let me show you it in action. So here I have a notebook, which again, it's available on GitHub repo. Let me see if I could make the font bigger. And so for the first example, example of what's called one hot encoding. So if you have a data that is composed of string values, then that the model algorithms like numbers. And so you need to somehow convert those string values into numbers. And you might think that you could just assign a numerical label to each value. But if you do that, so for example, cat, dog, and ostrich, you might say, okay, I'll make cat equal to 1, dog equal to 2, and ostrich equal to 3. The problem with that is you're implying an order. So remember, computers aren't that smart. So if cat is 1 and dog is 2, the computer is going to assume things like, oh, so dog is twice as important as cat, things like that. So we want to avoid an implied order. And so one way to do that is to do what's called one hot encoding. And what we do instead of assigning a number to each value, we assign a column to each possible value. So in this example, I have here some data here. You see I have a list of cars, Toyota, Ford, Tesla, and so forth, Honda. And I want to convert that to columns, right? So I instantiate an instance of this scikit-learn class called one hot encoder. And then down here at the bottom, you can see I call the fit transform method on that an instance. Okay, and I convert that to an array and a NumPy array, right? And then I'm going to print the results. And then I'm also going to do another example where I have two columns, one column of fruits, another column, again, of cars. And you'll see that that one is also going to be handled nicely, right? And I'll print the NumPy array I get for that, all right? So here is the original array of car values. And then below that, we see, all right, so there I have four different car types. And so you see the one hot encoding, scikit-learn gave me an array of four columns. And each row only has one value in each of those columns set. All right, so that's one hot encoding. And then in the other example, I had two columns. And so I just, again, make a bunch of columns to handle all of the values there. Right, so that's a very useful feature of scikit-learn. Now, there's other libraries, there's other support for one hot encodings, like Pandas also does one hot encoding, but the scikit-learn version is quite nice and useful, right? So now let's look at an example of using scikit-learn in order to build a model. Okay, so here we're going to make a classification model to detect, we're going to use a data set of human anatomy measurements and then use that to make a model that can detect the presence of breast cancer, right? So here is the code. And again, I'm going to do some basic steps that you will need in pretty much any machine learning, supervised learning at least model. So here after I load the data, in this case, scikit-learn has some data sets. So that's another nice thing. It has some canned data sets you can use for testing demos like I'm doing now. So I load the data from the scikit-learn library. And then here I call the train test split method in order to divide my data. into the training portion and test portion, testing portion. The input side and the output side are arrays. Okay, I do that. And then also I want to present the some summary statistics, or basically give you a feel for this breast cancer data set. And when you have a lot of columns, it's a struggle to try to communicate the sense of the data. So what I've done here is I printed a number of aspects, like the number of columns, the number of rows. So I'll go ahead and show you that. Okay, so you see there the at the top, you see the column names, feature names, and then you see the first row here has the count. So 569 samples. Okay, the average for each of these properties, features, the standard deviation, and so forth. Okay. All right, and then now what I'm going to do is I'm going to do a nearest neighbors model. And so here I'll just highlight a few lines. So I'm calling the K neighbors classifier class constructor to build a model, a nearest neighbors model. Then I call the fit method on that instance to create the model. All right, and then I calculate the accuracy and display the results. Now here, what I'm doing is I'm building a model for various values of K. So if you know the K nearest neighbors algorithm, you try to find the closest samples in your data set that is the closest to your what you're trying to make a prediction on, the input data that you're trying to get a prediction for. And so what I'm doing is I'm building several models for different numbers of neighbors, and I'm going to compare them and apply. So let me show you that. All right, so here, let me get some. Okay, so what I have here is, so this is the accuracy versus the number of neighbors that I'm using for my algorithms. Okay, is hyperparameter, as they'll say. All right, and so the blue is the training data. So it looks like as K gets bigger, it's not it's really not improving the accuracy. On the other hand, the testing, you see that it goes up and then it trends down slowly. So then the ideal K value is then whatever is spikier, is at maybe 4 or 5. Okay. So, and this was again all done with scikit-learn. So you can literally build your model and evaluate it within just this one level. Okay. Now there's other models. So here I'm doing the exact same thing with a decision tree model. Okay, so you see there, scikit-learn has a class called this decision tree classifier. And I specify in the constructor the maximum depth of the maximum number of levels for the decision tree. And then I have a random seed. All right, and then again, I call the fit method. And so here I printed some accuracy metrics. So here I got a 90% accuracy, and you see with precision recall, F1 score, all right? All of this is calculated from scikit-learn params, or library method, library calls, library functions. Okay, and then a little confusion matrix. So there's only two variables in this case, so you see they're not too big, okay? And then I'll run through some other examples. So here's doing the same thing using scikit-learn with its support for random forests. Okay, so there I call the random forest classifier constructor. Oops. Luckily, they did that in the game. All right, so random forest, again, the accuracy metrics, and then I do gradient boosted model, so the gradient boosting classifier constructor. So again, if you're interested in using Scikit-learn, you can just take my code here and use examples as a template, as a starting point. And what else do I have? Okay, so here, so those were all classifiers. So let me show you an example of a regression model. So here I found a data set that has the price of computer RAM, computer memory, and for several years. So I'm going to make a model to predict future RAM prices. All right, so I downloaded from our GitHub repo the historical RAM price data set. All right, and then I separate the data into training and test data, right? And then I make the plot to display the data so it's lookable. All right, so there you see, here I'm plotting the log of the price. Okay, the reason is that, well, it drops exponentially. And so by taking the log, we could make the plot linear, okay, a line. Okay, and so I've got here both the training and the testing data. Okay, so the training is everything before the year 2000. We'll train on that and then we'll test it, which we'll have it predict for years after the year 2000. Okay. And so here I call the linear regression class constructor of scikit-learn. And again, I can plot the metrics for regression metrics, in this case, mean squared error, root mean squared error, the mean absolute error, R squared value. Okay. So I printed the values here. And then here's a plot. Right? Now, at first, so what I did was I plotted here two models, the linear model as well as another one. And I take that back. This is just the linear model. So you see there, it makes a very nice line through the data, all right? So the prediction would be along that line. The green is for in the training region, and the red is in the testing region. And then I do the same thing with the decision tree model next, which is a little bit more sophisticated of a regression model. And so here, I have a question, a puzzle, data scientist question. All right, so the blue was the training region, and then the orange there in the bottom right was the testing region. So the decision tree, you'll notice it exactly tracks the training data. So it's doing great there. On the other hand, look on the bottom right. So when I try to apply the model in the testing region, I get the same stupid value. So why is the model not being used for outside of the training range? The no. It's a, it has to, it's a, this is a fault of, it's a limitation of decision trees. So this, a flow chart, a decision tree will give great results within some fixed interval. But if you veer outside of that, it doesn't have the ability to extrapolate, interpolate. Unlike other models, right, like the linear model, you can plug in any value.
Not predicting.
Well, decision trees are for a specific range, yeah. So if you go outside the range, what the decision tree does is it just gives you the last value. The last value then for everything beyond that will just predict the same stupid thing. Okay, so then that is some examples of using scikit-learn. And then I'm gonna now go into discussing XGBoost. And then when I do the demo of that, there'll be other usages of scikit. So let me not go back to these slides. Okay, so XGBoost. So XGBoost is an open source machine learning library. It helps with creating extremely accurate gradient boosted models. And so of course we all want to have accurate models. It turns out that gradient boosted trees are one of the best algorithms in general to make accurate classifiers and regressors. And XGBoost is one of the best implementations of gradient boosted trees. And it supports, again, the popular machine learning tools, Python, NumPy, Pandas, as well as many more tools. Okay. Now, why is XGBoost getting so much attention? So there's a couple of reasons. So the issue with gradient boosted models is they're really prone to overfitting. So they'll make an awesome model on the training data, but then when you go to the testing data, not so hot. Okay, when you go into production. So XGBoost really tries hard to prevent overfitting. All right. Also, it's the code. It's really nice optimized code. It's great at delivering fast training. Okay. And I didn't mention it here, but they also have it. It has a really small memory footprint. So it's just really well-designed code. And then adding to that about fast training, it's great at providing many parallelization options. So if you have multi-cores, you have GPUs, if you have Spark, like a Databricks platform, then XGBoost can take advantage of that to speed up training if you have a massive model you're trying to build. Okay. Now, it gets even better. So if you do a lot with scikit-learn, and scikit-learn is an awesome library, so I'd encourage you to familiarize yourself with it. Now, you don't have to then memorize a whole new nomenclature for XGBoost. They have wrapper functions, wrapper classes that use the same naming conventions that scikit-learn uses. So there's a class called XGB classifier, XGB regressor, which I'll show you in a minute. And they use scikit-learn parameters. So it's just a nice feature to make things even easier. Okay, now, so you are interested in XGBoost. You want to have high accuracies, the kind that win various machine learning contests. So in order to develop world-class models with XGBoost, you will have to get familiar, you'll have to get very skillful at parameter tuning. So there's lots of knobs, settings you can adjust in XGBoost, and developing skills, searching the space of those parameters is what will give you extremely accurate models. Now, unfortunately, what is defined as the best arguments, the best parameter values varies with your problem. So different data sets, different types of models you're trying to build will have different ideal parameters. And so that's why you have to do these searches and other techniques to try to find the best parameter for your specific problem. And again, a major goal when you're trying to pick the correct, the best hyperparameter values arguments is to prevent overfitting. That, again, that is what these gradient boosted models are prone to, okay? Now, since there are parameters that you're gonna get to know and love if you want to use XGBoost and tune it to your heart's content, let me go through some of the more popular parameters to tune. And there's other ones, but these are some of the main ones. So the N estimators parameter, that sets the number of decision trees. Remember, a gradient boosted model is a sequence of decision trees. And so here you can set the number that you want to use in your gradient boosted model. And then max depth, that sets the maximum number of levels in your decision trees. If you think about your decision tree like a flow chart, then you may not want it to become too detailed, too divided, because that again will lead to overfitting. All right. And then the learning rate, that sets the impact of any one decision tree. Okay. Also, when you're making your decision tree, you might lead to various nodes in your tree that aren't really doing much. Okay. And so you want to perhaps eliminate, you want to prune nodes that aren't really increasing your accuracy. And so there's a parameter that corresponds to that called min child width. Okay. And if the conditions aren't met, then when it's building a decision tree, it'll stop splitting. It'll stop adding more levels at that node. Okay. Again, and so the reason I'm going through all of these settings is this is the level you have to play in to make a really accurate model. So again, as part of our strategy to prevent overfitting, so here's some interesting parameters. So what if we didn't use all of the data for each decision tree? What if we randomly took a portion of it, 80%, 90%, and then by adding that randomness, that can conceivably also prevent overfit. And so that's what the subsample parameter does, okay? It sets the size of that random subset that we use for follow-on decision trees, okay? And so that is, so the subsample is only taking a random piece, a random chunk of your portion of your data, okay? Furthermore, you can set it to randomly use a subset of all your features, all your columns, okay? And so that's what the parameters that begin with call sample underscore by give you, okay? So you can set the how many, the percentage of features that you will use for each level of a tree, for different nodes of the tree, for different trees, okay? So that's why I have their tree level and node. Okay, so lots and lots of parameters here that you can set. Okay. And then we also have regularization parameters. So L1 and L2 regularization parameters, what those do is they penalize large weights more than otherwise, okay? And so the names of The L1 and L2 parameters are reg_alpha and reg_lambda. They are error function adjustments, okay? And then also there is another regularization parameter called gamma, okay? Now, you will notice that I didn't define what gamma is, and also I didn't define what min child weight is. I just gave you an intuitive explanation. So what this does is it's basically saying, okay, I'm going to stop paying attention to this portion of a tree if it's not helping much, okay? But nevertheless, if you insisted, there is a precise mathematical definition of what it means to define the importance of each piece of a tree. And so you can look that up, but that there is a precise definition of min child weight. And likewise, gamma, there's a detailed definition of that, which I don't want to get into now. Furthermore, even if I did give you the precise, sophisticated mathematical definition, you're not going to be able to, on pencil and paper, derive the correct value. You're going to have to just do a search. You're going to have to just try different values, you want to say, okay? So I don't know what my point is, I don't know how much it would help if you understood all the intricacies of the definition of each of these parameters. That at the end of the day, you're just going to want to try different values. All right, and so now let me go to my demo. All right, so remember we had the scikit-learn code. So here now is XGBoost code for making classifiers and regressors. So here in the first example, I have a data that can predict the categories of wines. So if I provide the attributes of different unknown wines, then we predict the type of wine that it is. Okay. And so here you see it looks a lot like the scikit-learn code. So first I'm using scikit-learn. I'm using scikit-learn here to prepare my data. So I have the same code here to split my data set into training and testing portions, all right? And then first I'm going to describe the data before I use XGBoost. But so here I'm printing, you can see there the column names, all right, sample values, the count, so in this case, I have three categories, 0, 1, and 2. Okay. Anyways, you get the idea, right? And so you can take a look at that if you like. So here's the code. This is the new stuff right here. So here's the code to create an XGBoost classifier. Okay. So I call the XGB classifier method. All right. And then I call the fit method. Now that is the same syntax as sklearn, so scikit-learn, so that's intentional. We're trying to follow some semblance of a standard, even if it's implied, okay? And then here I print metrics using scikit-learn, right? Just like before, okay? And so I'd simply running this model, I noticed I didn't have any parameters. I could have got really sophisticated and tried various values of all those parameters that I just showed you, right? The maximum depth of my decision trees and the regularization parameters, but just naively throwing in this data into the vanilla classifier, okay, got me to 91%. Okay, so that's not bad, right? And then you see there are the precision recall, F1 score, other metrics, thanks to scikit-learn. Okay. And then I have a confusion matrix. So, all right, now let me show you. So that was a classification example. Yeah, now let me show you a regression. So here I have a data set of California house prices. And so I want to make a regression model to predict house prices. By the way, I just thought of this right now. You guys have heard of Zillow? So Zillow is, that's like, that's a business I wish I would have found. That's like a data science business, right? So they're very good at predicting. They try to predict house prices. And so we can imagine these are some problems. Yeah, they got overconfident, leveraged themselves. Yeah, but the idea was still cool, though, using machine learning, right? All right, so here is the code for that. So again, you as I said, you do the similar things in all models. So I'm again have to split the data and so forth. All right, so I'm using the same scikit-learn libraries. All right, so I get the I do that. Okay, split, present the statistics. Okay, in this case, there's 8 features and 20,640 house examples, rows. Okay, so you see there my the column values, the feature names. Okay. All right, and then also this is not specific to XGBoost, but one way to present when you have lots of features. To present the relation between the data, the different relations, different aspects of the data is what's called a scatter plot matrix. And so this plots several scatter plots. It pairs up the different features and makes a scatter plot for each of those pairs. And then on the diagonal, it's common to have histograms of the features. And so a lot of data is conveyed in the scatter plot matrix. Now, I discovered that if you're familiar with matplotlib, it's a graphing library. So Seaborn is built on top of that, and that's even nicer still. Seaborn has really nice code to make scatter plot matrices. Anyway, so moving on. Okay, so here I made a regressors model, okay, and I'm going to use the root mean squared error for my goal is to minimize that. All right, so here you go, and so you see there the root mean squared error was 0.29. Mean absolute error 0.37, R squared 0.37, right? So there, and again, if you want to do an XGBoost regression model, you can again use this code if you like as a template. Okay, so now for my last example, I want to not just throw it into the default values of XGBoost. I want to show you something a little bit closer to what a real life example might be like. Okay. So here we have data for a Portuguese banking institution. So this is real data. What this Portuguese banking institution, what they did was they did a marketing campaign by phone, and they collected data on the types of customers and whether they signed up for a term deposit, as it's called, okay? And so then, of course, then it would be nice to know in the future, what types of customers should we focus on? Should we market to that are likely to become new customers, okay? And so this is a very common business problem that you might want to solve. You have data on your customers and you want to know what are the most likely customers for some new product that you should focus on selling. Okay. And so I have there the link. If you want more information about this data set, you can click on the link there. Okay. And then again, as we've said, seen multiple times before. So again, so I'm splitting, describing the data first before I use XGBoost. Okay. Now you'll notice here that the data as it was given to me is not all numerical, right? The job, there's different jobs there, entrepreneur, technician, management, marital status, married, single, education. And so are they in loan default, so forth. And so this is an example of what we have to deal with in real life. So now we have to clean up or modify this data to make it numerical for XGBoost. So the first thing we need to do, or first when we display the, so here's the summary statistics on the columns that are already numerical. Okay, so I can't obviously get an average, a mean for the string columns, but the, and then the scatter plot matrix for the numerical ones. Okay. And then, so now the first step I have to do then is numerically encode. Okay. So I'm using that same one hot encoding code I showed you in the Scikit-learn notebook. Okay. And right, and I have a for loop here, and so I'm just going to knock them all out in one shot, five columns. Okay, so there's a lot going on there. I'm building a pandas data frame, and with the new one hot encoded columns, and then dropping the old string column and adding the new one hot encoded columns. Okay, and so that's all done in this for loop, right? And then I've got one of the columns, there was four columns that had yes and no values. So we don't want to one hot encode those. We just want to convert the yeses to ones and the nos to zeros. Okay. And so here's code to do that on a pandas data frame using the map function. All right. And then the last one, so for the month, the month was given in strings, three-letter abbreviations. So we don't want to one encode that. We'll map to consecutive integers. And so I do that there. Okay. And then, all right, so then we display our data. And so you can see there the different values of these columns again. And then you can see there the final numerically encoded values. All right, so that's step one. And then now we'll split that data and do it again. Okay. And so we'll first do a naive, again, with no fancy hyperparameter tuning. We'll just throw it in the XGB classifier instance. Call the fit method on that instance and see what happens. Okay, and then we'll print out the accuracy metrics. So here we get 90.79% just with the defaults. Okay, and then below that you see the confusion matrix, precision, so forth. All right, so 90.79, and so what if that wasn't good enough? So we might want to now try to search for better hyperparameter values. So remember, we had maximum depth, and we had that subsample value that took a random subset for to train different decision trees on. So remember those, okay? So right now, I'm just going to try to search for various values of N estimators and max depth. Okay, so I'm gonna try 2, 4, 6, and 8 for the maximum depth. I'll try all of those values. And then for the number of estimators, the number of decision trees, I'll try 50, 100, 150, 200, and 250. So that's what these range, this code right here, range, that's what that's doing, all right? It's providing me a sequence of numbers to test, okay? And then I instantiate an instance of XGB classifier, and then here I'm gonna be doing something different. So now I'm gonna use this very nice sophisticated class in Scikit-learn called Grid Search CV. And that is gonna hide a huge amount of pain and work. All right, what am I talking about? So what you would, if you didn't have this Scikit-learn method, what you would do is you'd have a massive number of nested for loops, and you would try all of these different parameter values. You'd build various models using these different hyperparameter values. And then you'd want to do, if you were really careful, you want to do cross-validation on each of those models, save up all of the accuracies, and then see which one of those was the best. So there'd be a massive amount of bookkeeping, right? Well, so this scikit-learn code will encapsulate, will take care of a lot of that workflow, okay? So look how nice this is. So first I define here all the parameters that I want to search over, okay? And then I pass that's the setting, the values for this _grid parameter, all right? And then I want to pick the model with the highest accuracy, all right? And I pass in, I'm using XGBoost, so I'm gonna pass in my instance there of the XGB classifier method. By the way, I'm calling it an estimator. So just in case you're wondering, so a model is a machine, you plug in data and it gives you predictions. So think of an estimator as just a model builder. Okay, it's kind of a level before. So I have an estimator. So this is the model builder that I'm gonna use. So Grid Search CV is gonna build a number of models with that model builder using different types of parameters, okay? And then I take the instance of the Grid Search CV class that I've created, and then I call the fit method on that. So it's a lot like what you do without using Google Search, all right? And so by doing that, then it'll give us, it's what it finds out, okay? So I'm gonna print there the best parameters that it found, okay? And then I'm gonna also print other metrics. So you see there at the bottom, so after doing a search, the best depth was 6, and the best number of decision trees was 200. Okay. And so let's see the accuracy. Okay, 90.99. So that pushed it up a little bit. Okay. And then there's these other accuracy metrics. Okay, so now because I may even want to push it harder, so here you see there my list of parameters. Now I've added more, right? Now I have the learning rate, and now I have subsample. Remember that parameter? Okay, and so I'm trying different values there. Now, when I was running this at home, I could have, of course, used several more choices here, but in order to make it run, not take too long, you'll notice that for the number of estimators, I'm using the best one that my previous search gave me 200. And then for the max depth, I'm using the value of 6 only. So I'm fixing those and then I'm varying other parameters. Okay. Now, if you are trying to win a contest or if you are trying to put a model into production, of course, you would want to search over a much wider range of values. And so this is where you might want to use, right, something like GPUs or, right, Spark, okay, multiple cores. And there's setting, XGBoost has settings for all of that. And but this is what you probably want to do to make a really accurate, useful production of input, right? And so I do that. And so this time it didn't really help that much. Okay, I didn't really push it that hard. I didn't really try a lot of different values. But anyways, this is what you'd have to continue doing. Now, in addition to this grid search, there is also a similar class in scikit-learn that is used to do a random search. So if you have a huge space of values that you're trying to search over, you can, instead of meticulously going one by one through all of the vectors, all of the sets of values, you can randomly select different sets. And hopefully you will stumble upon an excellent choice without having to search the entire space. Okay, so you can do a random search. All right, so that's all I need.